Game On is brought to you by
Winning has never been this simple. Bet with 1xBet.
Game On. It's Game On. We are big on sports.
Well, just 24 hours to the start of match day 2 in Group A, Uganda Cranes up against Zimbabwe and Egypt up against DR Congo. Of course, that is a fixture we'll be talking about a little bit later. Before the break, Coach, we talked about, questioning you about the starting 11. We know whatever player played on Saturday deserved to be on the squad because you've got to field your strongest 11 on the opening fixture. Going into match day 2, we know what is at stake, what is required of them. Would you change your squad? Would you tinker with the 11? Would you maybe throw in a few new faces in there to see how they can actually march and then wait for the big one against Egypt?
Not at all. One, we achieved our goal on the previous match. We won that game and the team looked really well. So these players, at least they have an experience of at least 90 minutes better than those who are on the bench. They work together as a team and they did a good job. Secondly, it's now, like I said, the way we approach the game, it might be more easier for us to attack the opponents because we are going to concentrate more on counter-attacking. And if you talk of counter-attacking, you need players with pace. You need players who can run with the ball. Here you have Lumala, you have Okwi, you have Mia Farouk. These are the guys who are good at that. So there's no way you can think of now adjusting and bringing on someone else. You can only think of changing the team maybe towards the late stages of the game when either you need to kill it off completely, you need a draw, then you bring more defensive-minded players. But from the start, these are the guys we need.
Some of the benches, we had the chair left off, we had the dancing Rasta Katerega, we had Tadeo Luanga, Kizito Luaga, all those are potential starters, if I should say. Obviously, for Sebastian De Sebre, he's fourth for choice, like we mentioned right at the start when the team was named. Moving forward, Zimbabwe game, he needs the 3 points, but at worst, a point to go into match day 3 against Egypt.
Oh, yeah, I think ultimate target should be 3 points. If the worst comes, the worst, we could actually take a point from that particular game. But the names you've mentioned coming off the bench means that there's plenty of quality. If ever there's a need for rotation, if ever there's an injury, like the scare that was with with Lumala in the game against DR Congo. And certainly, you know, you look at the boys going forward and you think creating more chances is going to be very important. Farouk Mia continues to be the focal point for the team. He's the guy that is pretty much creating everything. He's the go-to guy in terms of set pieces. So you think he'll actually come in handy in the game, against Zimbabwe. And then also, I'd want to think that we should be seeing most of those chances, if they come through, actually getting buried, specifically from Patrick Card. We've seen his awareness is up there. He knows how to get into the air for his goal against Congo. He went in between center backs that would beat him on any day in terms of size. But his awareness and, you know, picking out the right spot and putting the ball away was very important. So when the chances come, we bury them, and then also keep creating as many as possible.
Quachadwella, let's paint a picture. Tomorrow, a win for the Uganda Cranes, 6 points in the bag. I don't know about the goal difference, but you go into the game against Egypt, having won your first two games. Do you rest your big names and prepare them for the knockout stage, or do you still field the same 11 that has been working for you right from match day 1 to match day 2 going into match day 3?
It is always better to field some new players for them, one, to get a feel of the tournament, two, to rest your players, because now from group stages, now we'll be planning for knockout stages, and then knockout stages, there's a certain quality of players, overplaying style you would need to introduce, because you can't continue playing the same way we are playing the group stages. Right now, we only play to get a point. Like tomorrow, we need a point. So you can play for a draw, good enough. Okay? Knockout stage, you need to qualify. So you need players who can always go up from there and then score you a goal.
Brian, let's put it this way. A win for Uganda Cranes against Zimbabwe, a win for Egypt against DR Congo, leaving it at 6 points. It will be a question, who does get a finish on top of the other? We know for a fact that we are yet to beat Egypt on their home soil, or even against Egypt. The last time we beat them, I think, was, remind me of the year. What year was that?
Egypt? Yeah, when we went for... there's a tournament, we went, and I think, who was the coach?
Mike Mutavi?
Not Mike. Not Mike.
Bobby?
Yeah, it was Bobby.
Okay.
It was Bobby. There was a tournament they had introduced in Egypt. I'm forgetting the name of the tournament. That's when we beat them 1-0. It was like kind of a shock, but they always humiliated us 6-0, 5-0.
The Nal Benson, is it? I'm sorry.
Yeah, it was Nal Benson.
Nal Benson. We have a very poor record, against Egypt. And I get the feeling, if I was Sebastian De Sèvres, the game that I would want to win would be against them, just to shut them down and make them and tell them that's a statement from us that we've arrived and now we need to be respected.
Interestingly, you talk about a scenario win against Zimbabwe and they actually pick up a win in their respective game against Congo. That would mean going into final match, they would all be level on 6 points, depending on how many goals you've scored vis-a-vis how many they've scored. You'd think that that would also determine who is actually top of the table. But if that were ever to happen, I think for us it would be beyond our wildest imaginations because going into the tournament, so many people are thinking if we get to finish as the third best team, qualify out of this, that will be as good as it gets. But if we get into a conversation for top in the group against the most successful side on the continent and then also the team that are hosting the tournament, I think for me that would be quite the stride that the Uganda Cranes have been able to hit. But let's wait and see. Certainly it looks like that is quite possible, which would mean that going into final match day, Egypt would actually come out there and battle for top spot and would also come out and battle for the same.
Uganda Cranes up against the Warriors tomorrow at about 11 p.m. That should be kickoff time. The venue is the Cairo International Stadium that did have the opening ceremony and the opening fixture between Zimbabwe and that is Egypt. The last time Zimbabwe played at that vicinity, well, they lost out and walked away with nothing but probably pride, having conceded just a one goal. And quickly, let's look into the groups. We'll be starting with Group A in regards to the African Cup of Nations. Uganda leading that group. I don't want to use the word temporal, but yes, leading that group with 3 points jointly with Egypt. The question there is, they have more goals compared to the Faroes, who scored one, with Uganda Cranes, who scored two. Now, in third place is Zimbabwe because they're considered lesser compared to DR Congo, who are rock bottom in that group. That is in Group A. Moving on to Group B. Group B does have Nigeria, who left it late during the opening fixture against Burundi, and right behind them is Madagascar and Guinea, who share the spoils in match day two after a 2-2 draw, and the East African side in Burundi are in fourth place. Now, Group C has Algeria, who somehow managed to go past the Harambe Stars with so much ease with two fine goals, including that from Baghdad and Riyad Mahrez. The Senegalese side is in second place, of course. They managed only one against Tanzania, who also came in third place, and Kenya, another East African side, in fourth place. Group D has Morocco, Ivory Coast, both on 3 points, having won their respective fixtures against Namibia and the Bafana, who fell out yesterday narrowly to Ivory Coast. Now, quickly, before we talk about the Women's World Cup, I'd like to ask the billion question. How far can the Uganda Cranes go, in your take, after what we saw against DR Congo? And would I be asking this question if the Uganda Cranes had lost against DR Congo?
It's a very hard question.
Very hard question.
We can go as far as the team is still organized.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Prophet in Boni has a different take because he says that, well, the Uganda Cranes will be winning the African Cup of Nations. We'll wait and see how that one there pans out. But quickly, let's walk away from that and talk about the FIFA Women's World Cup happening in France. The round of 16 will be concluded today. But yesterday, the defending champions in USA came out with a hard-fought victory against the Señoritas in Spain with two fine penalties taken on the day, thanks to, of course, the Capitano, who scored in the first and in the second half. And I want to believe they are on course to reclaim their title. And guess what? They will be facing hosts in France, who beat up on the South Americans in Brazil in the round of 16. Quite the outing for USA. Brian, you and I have been following the FIFA Women's World Cup. And yesterday, VAR falling in place, of course, with USA 2-1 winners over Spain. A brave Spanish side going home with frustration, at the same time with something to be smiling about.
Absolutely. I think for me, Spain going out of this tournament, they'll feel like they gave the absolute best. Unfortunately, their best wasn't good enough because they came up against a team like the USA, who are first of all firing on all cylinders, but then also quite importantly, perhaps felt like the bare minimum they needed to do was get into the quarterfinals, especially given that they are the defending champions, had such a strong start to the tournament. But the game yesterday was far from easy. They had to work every single moment to come up with that particular win, and it's going to be interesting to see what they bring to the table in their quarterfinal against the team France, because you look at France and USA right from get-go, the bookmakers had them as the favorites to go all the way and probably see how far they could actually stretch each other. So I think it's going to make for a very good game for the fans watching back at home, and the football should be exciting, but it's a very good thing for women's football because they've come that far, and it's good to see these two sides that have been at the forefront.
Coach Abdullah, we've seen the FIFA Women's World Cup take the tone, and many have actually embraced it, but the one standing out element has been the fine goals, the leg drama, but most importantly, VAR, video assistant referee, that has caused so much chaos. If I should say, good chaos. Recently, Cameroon felt hard done by VAR and by the referee in Queen Liang, who, of course, waved away one of their goals and then made one goal to stand. Clearly, VAR has actually done some good and some bad.
To my side, okay. I'll admit one thing, that I've never appreciated VAR. Reason being, it killed off that natural instinct that we used to enjoy in a game. Because in a game of football, we all know that it's a game of mistakes. Team can make a mistake, and the team just takes advantage out of a mistake made by the opponent, or the referee, or anybody. But you could go and live with that. Now, VR is kind of taking that away, so it is becoming too predictable. You always expect to know the results, okay? But I think I don't buy the idea of continuing to use VR. Otherwise, the championship now, like World Cup, it was very interesting. Very interesting if you compared to Africa Cup of Nations, because those ladies allow the game to flow. Okay, in the men's game, we are now concentrating so much on tactics. Tactics, how to prevent the other team from operating. So things just become as if teams play on a remote. Okay? we are always losing that natural abilities of people playing, okay, and enjoying the game. So the game is no longer flowing very well. But with the ladies, everybody, every team, whichever team comes, just they allow to play the game the way it's supposed to be played.
Megan Rapinoe is breast in on 7 minutes and on 76 minutes, deciding it for USA to go past Spain. Of course, now for USA, they get to face France, and three quarterfinals have been decided. We'll be having Norway facing England, while, of course, the other will be Sweden, who got past Canada yesterday, thanks to a long effort there from Stina. And they'll be facing the side in Germany. That should be this very Friday, whereby France will be up against USA. Tonight, we have two more fixtures to complete the round of 16. Italy will be up against China, and the winner of that affair will go on to face either the Dutch ladies or the Japanese ladies, who will be in contention later on tonight at about 10 p.m., while, of course, China-Italy gets to kick off at about 7 p.m. That's as far as the FIFA Women's World Cup is concerned. There's still some controversy over the Cameroonian women's team upon their behavior after they, of course, wanted to abandon the game between them and England, or Phil Neville. Phil Neville himself coming out to say that was simply absurd and that should be happening in football. Now, at this point in time, we get to introduce the man from Mbarara, that is in Osbat, which to tell us exactly what's happening with the timeline from yesterday. We had so much reaction from the timeline in regards to the Uganda Cranes winning against the other Congo, and also the East African neighbors in Burundi, Kenya, Tanzania losing out on the opening fixtures. Osbert does get to tell us exactly what's been happening from the timeline. Welcome, Osbert. It's good. It's been good. It's been good, especially. You look happy yourself.
Yeah, it's happy days. First off, with Zimbabwe. Good to have you, Brand, and Coach Abdullah. What is for you, TV and Fabian was it. And straight the time I went past saying I'll get one for one of the journalists who are on the ground in Cairo, in
Andrew Kabura.
Andrew Kabura says the way people are playing, but to win this AFCON, I'm telling you. Mm-hmm. And yes, comments very, very flowing in. So then this is one from Rudenda says, don't play with emotions, please. I don't know what he means. I think he sure means we should not be
carried away by that game against DR Congo.
Yeah, I would bring to the point what Coach was saying, having officials, having ministers, soon we have the president jetting, the minister of sports, the first lady jetting to Cairo. I think it somehow distracts the team from, we are already made next before we can make it. I think it goes for a couple of. And I would not agree with Rudenda there. My emotions have already been distorted. I don't know if I feel the right now point. 3 points, man, big. I don't know if we were fearing the match, first match, but we are very excited with this meeting. I hope we don't get distracted. And yes, straight to tomorrow's match. The Ugandans have now started a war. since yesterday, it's been a war. It has gone from football now to international challenge. We had fights online between Uganda and Kenya, Uganda and Nigeria. I've never seen one with Zimbabwe. So you see that mocking each other.
How to cut Zimbabwe? With bread and oil? Is that what they lack?
So sad tits, Ugandans. This is my prayer that we don't lose to Zimbabwe this Wednesday. Given the ongoing tour, this is Twitter war. This one of the Ugandan tips, we single-handedly help Uganda. They think one trip will win the fight.
I think that must have been Masana for yesterday. You know, they were complaining about their stage.
If we lose football, we will take it to Twitter.
Lol.
Even Zimbabwe is coming back to.
Oh, there's that one over there, the woman and the girl. Really? That's a caption of what?
Let me get the caption right up there.
So who is Uganda? Oh, wait.
We're going to explain the Zimbabwean that there is food on the other bread and chicken feet.
There's something there. Just.
From our very own, our suspect, if we are talking comedians online, this is one from.
So who tripped? There's one who tripped. Just if you scroll just a little bit down.
We had him yesterday.
He tripped on the ball. So who is that tripped? Oh, it can't.
Zimbabwe and Uganda, according to Geno here.
Oh, okay. There you go. That's it. Oh no, that's a hard fall, my friend. That's a very, very hard fall. So that is you trying to attempt to dribble, yeah?
Yes.
And the ball dribbles you.
This one says, don't say, Uganda better put us on the table tomorrow because the way we are already working, Zimbabwe, if you don't win tomorrow, I'm not going to do it. Zimbabwean football player of the month gets some bread, ice cream, and lotion. So mean. I swear this wouldn't beat this way. Yes, how tumbos are containing us. This is a picture. This is coming in from. I'll get this one from Zimbabwe and also now.
So what is that to do? What is that whole bread thing all about? I mean,
I think it's about Uganda. Some Ugandans fear Zimbabweans in a bad situation because of inflation. So they think they give them.
Just buy your way through, like, yo.
Here
we are. Just let us have the win. You can have the bread. You can have the oil. Oh, my goodness.
Is that president even this good looking? Yeah. I don't know how they managed to get that picture.
That is the cutest smile in East Africa. I mean, like it or not, that is one of the finest smiles we have.
So trust me or not, the fight is already on. The game is already on. It's started online. I doubt
what is Mugabe serving?
I don't know.
He finished all the chicken. Leave the man alone. He's in retirement.
I doubt there's KFC in Zimbabwe. I don't know if Zimbabwe KFC will help us win. Maybe someone should pack KFC for Uganda fans and Zimbabwe. Dear Uganda's perspective, you can please don't double check your spellings before you post. Oh my goodness, this must be from Zimbabwe.
Wait.
Heading the airport to catch the flight for tomorrow's Egypt versus Uganda. So yeah, then that's the picture from Fufa there, the press conference today. Yeah, so this is what everyone is wondering. Ugandans started the fight between Uganda and Zimbabwe. This is what everyone.
So, define inflation, and then the Google brings you up. Did you mean Zimbabwe? Are they that bad?
The difference between Uganda and Zimbabwe. In Zimbabwe, they still burn. In Uganda, I'm robust. Oh my God, millions of dollars. Oh my God, this is that's for
it's still bread related.
Oh my God, bread related. So we need 3 points against Zimbabwe, though we are not a good team, but we will really give our best to collect the maximum points so as to book the president. Mm-hmm. That's one from Pufa. Mm-hmm. Says team captain, Ghana's number one coach, goalkeeper. That's from the press conference for today. So yeah, so the interview has been a buzz right from as 2 days ago.
Mm-hmm.
By the way, look at the hashtag. It seems that we are going to have a orgasm.
An orgasm. An orgasm.
Yeah,
oh God.
Match talk online about tomorrow's game. We all can't wait for the action. We hope football will end the fight.
I tell you what. I hate to disrespect Zimbabwe, but it's important for coach to respect your opponent when you're going in for such a game.